Tonight, police investigate the stabbing death of a young Bagatelle man. The opposition SLP calls for the tourism minister to step down over recent statements about the failed Range Developments Resort project. A call for schools to explore ways of assisting rather than punishing parents with financial challenges. And First National Bank offers 100% financing to prospective homeowners. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Tuesday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. Our top story, police are investigating a stabbing at Bagatelle. The incident has left one young man dead and residents in shock. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
Dead is 18-year-old Glendon Barthelmy. Barthelmy was involved in an altercation with another individual when he was fatally stabbed.
Residents and friends of the deceased, reluctant to speak to the media, disclosed that the alleged assailant was known to the deceased.
They were friends. I didn't know they had any problems until when I saw him on the ground, dying, bleeding out.
He live around it?
No, well, he came on vacation, I guess. He's not from Bagatelle, he's from Soufre.
One individual, upon hearing the commotion outside, recalls what transpired after.
My friend Melvin, he said that they stabbed Glenel. When I came outside, Glenel fell. His last words was, Gasser, dog, you stabbed me, and then he fell. And I was in his eyes. I saw his eyes just roll back. I couldn't stay anymore. I had to just.
Glendon Barthelmy was an aspiring footballer who played for Big Players football team from Marshall. He has been described as a cool and calm individual with a bright future. He stayed away from trouble and focused on perfecting his football skills. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The opposition St.Lucia Labour Party has refuted claims by Tourism Minister Dominic Fede that the former government sold 40 acres of land at Black Bay Vifor to investment and hospitality company Range Developments 4 days before the 2016 general election for a luxury touristic project in the south of the island, which never materialized. The SLP says it is the United Workers Party administration which sold the land to the developer last year and called for the head of Tourism Minister Dominic Fede for the manner in which the matter is being handled. Here is Don Nicholas.
The government claims that the SLP administration sold the Black Bay land to investment and hospitality company Range Developments 4 days before the 2016 general election. But the SLP is saying that's not true. On Tuesday, the party showed the media a document which contained a September 11, 2017 date, which the Labour Party claims was the date that the UWP administration sold the land to the developer.
The minister says there was no dispute. What the government was trying to do was get back the land which was sold by the SLP 4 days before the elections. I won't say much on this, except to share with you a document issued by the government land registry yesterday, August 27, 2018. It shows that the land was sold on September 11th, 2017.
Dr. Hilaire has called on Tourism Minister Dominic Fede and other officials involved to resign. He also questioned the $54 million investment sales figure, which Mr. Fede says the developer was able to rake in.
Page 7 of the estimates for 2018-2019 says that for 2016-2017, $5.9 million EC dollars was earned. It also says that for 2017-2018, $21.4 million was earned. That gives us a total of EC $27.3 million from all sources.
The government has promised to issue a statement on the matter. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In more political news, the opposition SLP is busy attempting to drum up support for its protest march scheduled for Sunday, September 9th, 2018. Castries East MP and opposition leader Philip J. Pierre held a town hall meeting last evening to garner support for the march to protest government's management of the public health system and plans to privatize the OKEU hospital. Sheffield Gillard has that story.
The date September 9th also marks the 9th anniversary of the devastating St. Jude's Hospital fire that resulted in the death of three patients and led to the hospital operating out of the George Odlem Stadium. Opposition leader Philip Pierre says the march is not only to remember the lives lost in the fire, but also to draw attention to the government's alleged mismanagement of the health sector.
It is to appraise the constituents of why we are marching, to appraise them on the situation in healthcare, to appraise them about the situation in the country, and it's where we have to show the government that we are dissatisfied with what's happening. And in a democratic country, our right is to do it peacefully. And September the 9th, we're going to be demonstrating peacefully to show our government our utter disgust to the situation in the country.
While protest marches have become the norm in St. Lucia, their effectiveness has been questioned by some. But according to the opposition leader, freedom of expression is a hallmark of any democracy.
It is not right to say marches are not effective. What politicians are afraid of the most are people. Because in the final analysis, in our system, it's people are the ones who put us in power. So by bringing thousands of people on the streets to show their utter dissatisfaction and disgust with the government, that we want to send a strong message. And we don't want it only to be a march of the Labour Party. This is why this town hall meeting is for everyone. We want it to be a movement for change, a movement to make people understand that we are not happy with what's happening in the country.
Castries North candidate for the SLP, Mr. John Chowdhury, noted the party's commitment to addressing the issues affecting the health sector if returned to office.
If we get into power tomorrow, that we'll be taking care of universal health care, we'll be taking care of the whole country's health institute to make sure that things are properly done properly in this country.
The town hall meeting was held at the Marshall Combined School. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
A former school principal is calling for schools to explore the possibility of setting up a student's welfare committee to help underprivileged children struggling with school expenses. The call comes amid reports that parents are being denied book lists over unpaid facilities fees. Don Nicholas explains.
Former principal of the Miku Secondary School, Gibeon Ferdinand, recalls that during his tenure, a student welfare committee was set up to help underprivileged children meet school expenses. In 1 year, according to Mr. Ferdinand, the school was able to raise approximately $40,000 through fundraisers. Mr. Ferdinand's recommendation was prompted by reports that parents are being denied book lists and uniform patterns because they fell behind on school payments. But the former school principal quoted Section 15 of the Education Act, which emphasizes a child's right to education.
But the Education Act under Section 14 and 15 is clear about the right to education in public schools for children. And it also indicates under which conditions a child may be denied either education or access to the school, and not being able to pay school fees is clearly not one of them.
Mr. Ferdinand admits that schools must strike a balance between collecting the fees and providing an education. He also acknowledges that there are some parents who can afford to pay but are delinquent, while others simply cannot afford it.
There are students who just are not able to pay the facilities fees. They just cannot afford it. I can use the example of my school, my former school, what we did. There are situations where you have to meet the students halfway. We were able to, for example, set up a welfare committee that provided the students with assistance. So children who were not able to afford their books, transportation, uniforms, even food, the welfare committee was set up to raise money, and we would offset those costs.
Mr. Ferdinand is hoping that there can be an amicable solution to the problem. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. What do you think are people's perception of St. Lucians living overseas?
Nothing good. There is a lot of St. Lucians in St. Lucia right now going up St. Martin. Not St. Martin only, but as well as Laba, doing bad things. Yeah, so we St. Lucians have no good reputation in our close neighborhood islands.
Well, St. Lucians living abroad, some of us, we go to work, but sometimes other times we just look for other things to do. Now, anywhere St. Lucians go, most of us, we doesn't have a good reputation because sometimes people identify you. And some of us do so many things, so we just want to live our life accordingly.
Personally, I'm of the opinion that St. Lucians live overseas for many different reasons. So I don't think it is my place to judge anyone as to whether it be negatively or positively, you know. To me, it's their business. And if it's a case where it's not affecting us here directly in terms of crime and so on, why make it our personal business? Because people have many different reasons why they live abroad.
Well, based on what I see, we talk about our people here, but most of our people are going abroad and we know that they are trying to make a living for themselves. And also some of them go away and they commit crimes and different things are happening and it looking bad also on St. Lucia. But we're talking about our people here, but what's about our people over abroad? That's why we have to try our best to live right, live clean, and do what we have to do. You understand? And put God first in our life.
For years I've heard most people say, even St. Lucians say, that St. Lucians have gone to Martinique and they have damaged the reputation there. Can I support that argument? I don't know. But for whatever it's worth, I think anywhere you go in the world, there is good and bad. I believe St. Lucians are good people. I don't believe that we are that wicked that a stigmatism should be placed on us at that magnitude. So whatever it is, I think St. Lucians abroad should be very careful, because one St. Lucian can cause a lot of things to be said. So we have to be extremely careful where we are, what we do, and how we go about doing it.
You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Street. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much, Alex. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, UNAIDS called for greater investment in HIV treatment and prevention programs, and a local bank offers prospective homeowners 100% mortgage financing. Welcome back to the broadcast and thank you so much for staying with us. First National Bank has taken the lead as the first commercial bank on island to offer St. Lucians 100% fully financed mortgages to achieve their dream of home ownership. This groundbreaking news was announced at a ceremony at the bank's head office in Rodney Bay as part of the institution's 80th anniversary celebrations. We have more in this report.
While the average St. Lucian may have aspirations of owning his or her own home, the deposit or down payment usually required by commercial banks across the island for the mortgage has made realizing that dream very challenging for most. Today, however, First National Bank, in celebration of its 80th anniversary, is tearing down that barrier to give St. Lucians an opportunity to become homeowners with the first ever 100% finance mortgage offer to hit the St. Lucian market. Managing Director of First National Bank, Jonathan Johannes, says this new promotion is all about making the lives of St. Lucians better.
Many times we access social media and we look at the promotions that we put out and those of other banks, and we tune into the comments that customers make. And the number one comment that we always see whenever we do a vehicle promotion or a land promotion, it's when will a bank step up to the challenge and offer St. Lucians similar terms to what they can get on a vehicle?
According to Mr. Johannes, this life-changing offer was rolled out to coincide with another major milestone in the bank's history and therefore came with a limitation.
In our 80th year, we are going to limit the 100% financing on our mortgages to the first 80 customers who qualify. And I'm saying it again, the first 80 who qualify. So you need to get to First National quickly. You need to express your interest. You need to start the application process because it will only be available to 80 customers as we celebrate our 80th anniversary.
St. Lucia nationals residing both on and off island are also able to benefit from the promotion.
We want to make the lives of St. Lucians better, no matter where you live. And we are encouraging persons in the diaspora, if you have the dream of returning home or if you have the dream of owning piece of St. Lucia, now is the time with the 100% mortgage offering. We're also going to be talking to some of our developers on island to see if there's opportunity for them to also market this, not only in St. Lucia, but outside St. Lucia to potential clients and clients that they may have.
The management and staff of First National Bank are extremely excited about the 100% financed mortgages, which they believe will improve not just the living conditions of St. Lucians, but make a positive impact on their entire outlook on life for themselves and many more generations to come. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
UNAIDS is calling for increased national investments in HIV prevention and treatment as part of a broader health strategy. The call was made during an HIV-AIDS summit being hosted here from August 26th to the 30th. The summit is being held under the theme From Cure to Cure Towards the Elimination of HIV. It refers to an earlier summons for a country-led movement to scale up HIV prevention programs as part of fast-tracking a comprehensive response to meet global and national targets and commitments to end AIDS as a public health threat by 2030. Here is Don Nicholas with
UNAIDS officials noted that between 2006 and 2017, international resources for the region's AIDS response decreased by 16%, and that in 2017, just under half of the money needed to finance the achievement of the Fast Track program to end the AIDS epidemic in the region was not available. Treatment as prevention is an approach to HIV treatment which forms the basis of a global commitment to end the AIDS epidemic by 2030 as part of the Sustainable Development Goals. Chairman of the Caribbean Cytometry and Analytical Society, Clive Landis, says HIV is not a death sentence.
And further, to understand that persons living with HIV who have suppressed virus on medication are non-infectious. Only then will the community be able to rally in any meaningful way behind the somewhat arcane-sounding UNAIDS 1990-90 goals to help defeat this disease.
The summit brings together regional and international HIV experts to explore scientific renovations and social interventions that will accelerate progress toward ending the AIDS epidemic as a public health threat. Already, the Caribbean has enjoyed a measure of success, including the validation of 7 countries as having eliminated mother-to-child HIV transmission. Thanks to antiretroviral treatment, many victims are now living long, productive lives. The treatment can also reduce sexual transmission. According to the UNAIDS 2018 Global AIDS Update, there were an estimated 310,000 people living with HIV in the Caribbean at the end of 2017.
There is help, there is hope, and you can continue to live a very healthy and long life even if you are infected with HIV. So for St. Lucia, this is a very, very important event that is taking place right here, and I hope that it gets out to the public and for more people to know that there are such programs.
The summit ends on August 30th. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The St. Lucia Air and Seaports Authority is facilitating a survey capturing sonar data of St. Lucia's main ports and approaches. This is being done in association with the UK Hydrographic Office as part of the Commonwealth Marine Economies Programme. The survey is taking place in the waters off Rodney Bay, Castries, Marigot, Fierfort, and Souffre.
The government of St. Lucia, through the St. Lucia Air and Seaports Authority, is facilitating the upgrading of navigational charts with specific focus on major ports in St. Lucia. The underwater survey is being undertaken by the United Kingdom Hydrographic Office. The activity is being funded by the United Kingdom government under the Commonwealth Marine Economies Programme. For the next few weeks, this vessel, clearly marked survey, will be spotted along the west coast conducting the survey of main ports and harbors in St. Lucia.
So it's very, very important that at any country, any maritime state, that they chart their waterways. We have to show the international community that our waters are chartered.
This operation will continue until October. The survey will enable the identification of underwater objects and features, from shipwrecks to potential dive sites and the safest navigational approaches into harbors. Phil Payne is a member of the survey team.
We're here measuring primarily the bathymetric depth of the water, so just how much water there is under the sea surface. At the same time, we're also taking some other measurements to do with the tidal regime in the island, and also to have a look at what's actually on the seabed, so some of our partner organisations can follow up that work with more sort of environmental type studies later on in the programme.
This survey will help St. Lucia meet its international obligation to the International Maritime Organization. This calls for updated navigational charts providing safety information to marine interests. That information can also help demarcate multiple use areas.
So for example, they may have no anchoring areas. That survey will tell the country planners as to where boats can and cannot anchor based on the depth of water and based on if there are any reefs in the water. So it'll give us a clear idea as to how beneath the seabed looks, and that can only augur well for the government of St. Lucia, infrastructure and other ministries that are hoping to invest in the maritime sector.
Very expensive equipment is being used to capture the sonar data required. It has powerful GPS equipment that will help pinpoint with great precision locations of shipwrecks or underwater features. All information gathered will be shared with the government of St. Lucia. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buski.
And now this. The St. Lucia Nurses Association says the island has lost a gem of a nurse in Linda Rampersad, affectionately called Rampy, who died on Sunday. The association says she epitomized what nursing stands for. She was described as humble and loving and full of humor. Patients under her care came out cheerful despite her aches and pains. Rampersad touched the lives of many. Her colleagues don't remember ever seeing her upset, and she always had words of encouragement for them.
She gave exemplary service to the people of St. Lucia, and we have lost a gem of a nurse. Rampy, as she was affectionately known, touched many lives. We never saw her upset. And we, the nurses of St. Lucia, need to remember her by showing love for each other. That is something we need to do. We need to stop fighting each other and work together.
Nurse Rampersad died at the Victoria Hospital last Sunday. Two companies team up to help persons living with diabetes. I'll tell you more in just a moment. So for residents and neighboring community members are asking Lucilec, the island's sole power company, to give an explanation for the closure of the Lucilec office in Soufre. Customers say their only other alternative is to use the SharePay offices, which they claim are not always reliable.
The office have been shut or closed for the past 3 months, and nobody is aware as to what is going on. People have to run to SharePay, and the SharePay have 4 desks in Soufre Cooperative, Jacques Choiseul, and the 2 banks. But nobody knows, an airline, sorry, nobody knows as to what is happening. I met with some of the representatives last Friday. I questioned them what is going on, because sometimes you have to travel to cashiers if you're not too positive that Shopee will go straight to the system. You have to pay $26 to get to cashiers, and so then you have to get to Lucilec, that's another set of money. You have to get food to it. So you pay more than you bargain for. So if Lucilec can come and tell us what is happening in Soufre with the office, then people will have a side of relief, because nobody knows.
The corporate communications officer at Lucilec, Carmi Joseph, has apologized to Lucilec customers for the closure of the Soufre office since April the 3rd, but insists that the four Sharpay locations in Sufre are reliable. However, customers must complete transactions before Sharpay outlets cut off time.
The office was closed for renovations, and we expect to have word by the end of September as to what will happen with that office. I know the customers have been seeing some work may have been happening there over the past couple of months, because we want our staff to be comfortable as well as we want our customers to be comfortable and to be safe. And the purpose of doing the work was to address any, you know, mold, any issues with the office. Our staff was having issues in there, so we wanted to make sure that everything was okay. But we do understand where our customers are coming from, and we want them to know that Sharpay is open until 3 o'clock to allow for you to make your payments. And what that means is, if you get to Sharpay before 3 o'clock on any given day, your payment is processed on that same day. So in other words, if you are worried that your account might be in arrears or might be in danger of being disconnected, you can have the option of going to any Sharpay location. It doesn't have to be in Soufre or Choiseul. You can access our offices at V4, at Rodney Bay, or at St.lucia. But if you're using Sharpay before 3 o'clock, your payment is processed on that day. And that will allow your payment to be taken in by our office, and the payment will be registered, and you will be reconnected if that is your issue, if that is the issue that the customer is facing.
Lucilec says it will make an announcement on the reopening of their Soufre office by the end of September. Local wellness company Bon Santé has partnered with Collins Barbados Limited to distribute glucometers to the public free of cost. The company says part of the problem with the individual fight against diabetes is the lack of consistently available affordable strips. Bon Santé and Collins Barbados Limited are pledging to address this concern by ensuring an affordable and reliable supply of strips to persons living with diabetes.
General practitioner at Bon Santé, Dr. Kedma Dor, says the idea of giving free glucometers to the general public is a small start in the big fight against diabetes.
Everybody has or knows someone who's diabetic, at least one person. So diabetes is really everyone's business. And we all know one of the major challenges right now is the proper monitoring of our blood sugar levels. And most diabetics or most persons would say that their issue is obtaining strips. So we've actually sought out a reliable brand, a reliable supplier. And Collins has identified themselves as that brand or that group or that supplier. So the brand is Skyera. It's not a new brand to the region or to the island. There are other major pharmacies on island supplying it already. But what we will be doing is giving away some for free.
The glucometers will be given out on Wednesday, August 29th at the Bon Santé office on Chisel Street, adjacent to the Methodist Church in Castries.
Diabetes is one of the most prevalent non-communicable diseases in the world right now, meaning you can't get it from someone by just touching them or by being around them. And truth be told, the incidence or the prevalence is going up because of our lifestyle. All right, so I just want to plug this in right now. Our lifestyle has been changing over the years. We're getting a lot more sedentary. We're getting a lot more BHDs, as I call it, barely hanging down. All right. And as a result, we get a lot more chronic conditions, and diabetes is one of them. In terms of prevalence, I could put it this way. Everybody in St.lucia knows at least one person who's diabetic.
Bon Santé Inc. and Collins Barbados Limited will also donate a portion of the glucometers to the Diabetes and Hypertension Association, the Victoria Hospital Diabetic Clinic, and the St. Jude Hospital Diabetic Clinic for distribution to their members and clients. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
Sports is next when the DBS News World continues. You're just in time for the usual reminder. Police investigate the stabbing death of a young Bakatel man. The opposition SLP calls for the tourism minister to step down over recent statements about the failed Range Developments Resort project. A call for schools to explore ways of assisting rather than punishing parents with financial challenges. And First National Bank offers 100% financing to prospective homeowners. as a broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Pooley. I'm wishing you a very good evening. Coming up at 8:30 right here on DBS Television, What's Happening Now with Laura. Good night and see you next time.